Let's open the floor for questions. Jay.
So I had two questions. So the first one is, when you were discussing this symbolic analysis of loops, and after we have done the analysis and figured out that sum has a value that depends directly on the iteration number, you said that now we can parallelize the loop. But even if I replace the value of ai and this is the value of sum, but the statement sum plus equals it still has an output dependency of the iterations, right?
No, the idea is that because we have been able to identify that sum equals, let's say, k into k minus 1 by 2 or I into I minus 1 by 2 for the ith iteration, then we can just, you know, that becomes a closed form expression, right? And so we can just compute that. We don't need to do sum equals sum plus I.
So we can treat it as dead code and just move the statement.
Yeah, we just replace it, yeah. So we just replace that sum equals sum plus I. We just remove that statement and then we can just put. So, I mean, first of all, here we are talking about analysis, but now once we have the analysis, we figured out that at this particular point, the sum is basically going to have the value I into I minus 1. And we are interested in parallelization. So what we're going to say is, okay, for parallelization, I'm interested in removing loop carry dependency. So I don't want to depend on the old value of sum that was computed in the previous iteration. And so do I have an available expression that does not have this dependency? And the answer is yes, because of our induction variable analysis. And so we will be able to just replace sum equals sum plus I, I mean, with sum equals, let's say, k into k minus 1 by 2 or something like that.
Okay. I had a question from the natural loop part. Why should we care if a graph is reducible or not? I mean, so given the algorithm, we would just find the dominator relations and check if for each edge if it is a back edge or not, and then
can you repeat the question?
Why should we care if a graph is reducible or not? I mean, because a figuring out if a graph is reducible seems rather extensive, and because I'll have to consider all the DFNs, and so why should we even go there?
Okay, so first of all, what is the significance of identifying whether the graph is reducible or not? Why do I even need to do that? Why do I even care about that? So first of all, as our induction variable analysis would have motivated, hopefully, loops basically lend themselves to deeper analysis. Like the induction variable analysis is, for example, only possible, or the loop trip count analysis is only possible if you know that the cycle is a loop, is a natural loop, right? If it is not a natural loop, then there are two entries to the cycle. And if there are two entries to the cycle, then it becomes harder to talk about loop trip count or induction variables or things like that. So that's one thing. Now the question is, why do I care whether the graph is reducible or not? First of all, I think you made a statement that to identify whether a graph is reducible, I need to basically go through all possible DFNs, depth first numberings, and see that whether they are the retreating edges are back edges or not. That's not true. Okay. How do I identify that a graph is reducible? Is it true that if I want to identify a reducible graph, then I need to go through all possible depth first numberings? Firstly, is that the statement you made, Jay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is that true? I don't think so.
Sir, we could dominator relationships for each edge and check if for a retreating edge if the relation holds or not, and if any, if the edge is present like this, then you can say it is not.
So that's right. I imagine that if a graph is not reducible, I would see a retreating edge that is not a back edge for any DFN. Okay, I'm not proving this statement, but at least, you know, from the examples that I can think of. So the canonical example of a non-reducible graph is A, B, and C, and B and C have a cycle among them, and A can reach both A, B, and C. Now you take any depth first ordering or any DFS, depth first search traversal of this loop, and you're going to find that you're going to come across a retreating edge where the destination does not dominate the source. So you're going to identify that it's a retreating edge for that particular depth first numbering, and you're going to find that, and you can do any one, right? So you don't have to actually go through all possible depth first numberings. Just you take any depth first numbering and you're going to find a retreating edge that is not a back edge if the graph was not reducible. Agree or disagree?
So you're saying that if a graph is not reducible, each DFN will have that property, then I'll have at least one edge which is retreating but not a back edge.
Yes. There'll be some edge that will be a retreating edge but not a back edge. Okay.
I'll think about that.
Yes. So there's something I thought about. I think. And I, given that I'm not really giving a proof here, I'm just making a claim. It needs to be thought about, but let's go with that, okay, for now. Okay, now the question is, so it's not so difficult to identify whether graph is reducible or not. Now the other question is, why do I care whether the graph is reducible or not? Now, one thing is, of course, you know, I want to know whether the graph, a reducible graph has a very nice structure. You know, all cycles are basically loops, and loops have this very nice structure that they have a single entry point. So I can think of a loop as a kind of a sub program inside a larger program that has a single entry. And now I can analyze each loop in isolation and kind of keep composing these things. The kind of analysis that I can do on reducible graphs would be more precise than the analysis that I can do on non-reducible graphs. Now, the reason I think you're asking this question is because so far we haven't studied any analysis that differs apart from the induction variable analysis. We haven't really studied any analysis which basically, you know, gives different results if it was a reducible graph versus if it was a non-reducible graph. Because after all, DFA doesn't really care whether it's a reducible graph or not. That's a very valid statement. DFA doesn't care. You know, DFA just talks about nodes and edges. It doesn't really care about loops and reducibility and things like that. But our next topic, which we're going to do next week, we're going to talk about region-based analysis, and that would depend on whether the graph is reducible or not. And region-based analysis is a very important analysis as well, and a very successful and very well-used analysis. It's an improvement over DFA. Okay. So we've already seen an example where, you know, the analysis can be made deeper because you know that it's a natural loop. And we want to generalize this idea that, you know, you want to make the analysis more precise by exploiting the structure of the program. In particular, reducibility really helps in that well-structuredness. Okay. Yeah, thanks for the question. Okay. More questions or thoughts? Okay, so I have a question then, which is, Akshin, you have a question. Okay.
Yeah, am I audible, sir?
Yes, you are.
Okay. So I have a question. So in these videos, and I believe last week as well, when you were introducing natural loops, you said that most loops are natural loops. So my question is, where is this sort of unnaturality coming from? Like, is that from RDFA, or is that like something coming from language design? Like, why would a loop not be natural? Okay. Like, if you write a for loop, wouldn't that be natural when you consider like something like a C language semantics?
Yes. I think we tried to discuss this in our last meeting as well. So almost all structured control flow like for, while, repeat until, if then else, they just they just form natural loops. They cannot, you cannot create an unnatural, a cycle, not a natural loop without but if you use a go-to, then you open yourself to unnatural or non, a cycle that is not a natural loop, okay?
So if you consider a language like C minus the go-to, like would a lot of all this analysis be not needed then, if it's just go-to? Or like, does our DFA analysis in, do something, because we're adding basic blocks and we're always, trying to create some edges that we might create some unnaturality?
I see. No, so typically transformations made by compilers do not convert a natural loop to a cycle that is not a natural loop, okay? That doesn't, that, I mean, that would be actually, that would be counterproductive. That's, why would you do that? Because if you do that, then you're basically making it harder for the future algorithms or future passes to do better things with your program. Okay, so typically nobody will do that. Okay, now so the question is then, why do I need this analysis? Notice first of all that this analysis actually used to confirm that your program is reducible or it has only all cycles are natural loop. Because if you don't confirm that, and then just start doing your make assumptions that all cycles are natural loops, that would be incorrect, right? So you need to confirm this property before you actually use that property, isn't it? So that's why this property, confirming this property is important. And that's why, we have to talk about, we have to define a property, and then we have to talk about the algorithm to identify that this property holds. Because, if the program doesn't hold, and it is possible to have go-tos, and so it is possible to have construct programs that do not. And it's not just, so the other thing here is that optimization. So for example, C minus go-to would construct only reducible graph. But what about an intermediate representation? Typically, our analyses are happening on the intermediate representation. So because the C program was reducible, if I just do a one-to-one syntactic translation from C to the intermediate representation, which means, for every operation, I basically, just like the code generation algorithm that we have studied before, then we are guaranteed to get to obtain a reducible graph. But now if I start doing, if I start doing transformations, then it is possible that I start generating non-reducible graph. Now, I already said that typically transformations will not produce non-reducible graphs. But at the very end, for example, at the assembly level, compilers do sometimes produce non-reducible graphs. I mean, at the assembly level, you would find control flow graphs that are non-reducible. And this is, these are like last level optimizations where you say, oh, this code and this code, they seem identical. Why don't I just merge them into two? And you basically create a control flow, which basically doesn't look like a reducible graph anymore or something like that. Although that is, I would say that is, again, rare. I mean, actually, even most of the times, even assembly programs remain reducible. But these are all possibilities. I need to check against these properties before I start using those properties. That's a short answer.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. So my question here is that, I'm talking about induction variable analysis. What is the induction variable analysis? I mean, is it a completely separate analysis, or is it part of the DFA, a certain DFA that we're already aware of? I mean, what if, the loop was embedded inside a larger program? Now I start doing everything inside the loop, but I cannot just analyze the loop in isolation, right? So I need what is the first value, entry value of a certain variable, right? So how do I get that entry value? I mean, how am I kind of tying this whole thing together? Like, the induction variable analysis I've discussed in my modules is in the context of a single loop, but the loop is not living by itself, it's living in a larger program. So how did I do this in the modules?
Thank you.
So we can use it as part of a DFA, and then maybe we can do region based analysis inside the DFA, more precise analysis. For example, we can maybe we can do this as part of a more precise available expressions analysis. The example like induction variable analysis.
Right. So basically, the induction variable analysis is actually an improvement on available expressions, isn't it? I mean, I'm just running available expressions on the whole program. But then when I come to the loop, then I want to do a deeper analysis. So, I mean, if I didn't do the induction variable analysis, then the available expressions set that I would have got would have been smaller. So basically I'm riding on top of the available expression analysis and improving it, right? It's not like it's a standalone analysis. It's sitting on top of an existing analysis. And so it is because of that existing analysis that I'm able to get the first value. And then for a particular loop, I can say, okay, for this particular loop, I know that this particular sequences of basic blocks or this particular sub control flow graph is actually a loop. And now I can analyze it more deeply to basically produce richer relationships vis-a-vis available expressions, right? So that's what it is. Okay. So yeah, I mean, I just wanted to point out that, you know, it's not like these loop analyses are sitting in isolation. They're actually, you know, just improving existing DFA. So the DFA theme is continuing. It's just that we are having a more precise analysis to improve it. And that's going to be also the theme that we're going to have in the next set of modules for the next week. We're going to talk about generalization of this, and which we call region-based analysis. But we don't, I don't really expect you to know it now. Yeah, there will.
So we talked about the formal definition of natural loop, like we need to find a package, and then for that package the destination should be, we declare the destination as a header of the loop, and then accordingly we get the nodes between those nodes that are present inside the loop. But we will also need to get the relationship between those nodes, right, to formally define a natural loop. For example, if we merge two natural loops that have common header, then we will need to track more packages and then different nodes inside those loops, and also do we need to track the edges and for example serial or parallel combinations of edges?
Okay. Absolutely. So I had this in the modules. If I didn't, I'm going to explain this. So basically, what is a natural loop? A natural loop is a set of nodes and edges. In particular, a natural loop is a subgraph of the larger control loop graph, right? So of course, any subgraph will have nodes and edges. No, we don't need to worry about serial parallel compositions or anything like that. I think you're going in the wrong direction. I mean, basically what we need to worry about is what are the nodes and then what are the edges. And I think I answered this question in my modules, which is, you know, once you have identified the head of the loop, once you have identified the back edge, from the back edge, you know the head of the loop, and you also know the tail of the loop, which is the start of the back edge. Now from that, you can figure out what are all the nodes that belong to this loop. Right, all the nodes basically can reach the tail without going through head. Right, tail of the loop, or basically the source of back edge. Right, and there could be multiple back edges. So all back edges that are going to the same header, they are all part of the same loop. Okay, and so there are multiple back edges. So any node that can reach because there are multiple back edges, there can be multiple loop tails. There'll be only one loop head, but there could be multiple loop tails. But there could be multiple packages that are going to the same head. Right. Now I basically look for all nodes that can reach any of these loop tails without going through the loop head. And now that becomes my set of nodes of the loop. Now for the set of edges, any edge whose source and destination are both belonging to the same is a set of the edges. Okay. And so that's how I'm defining a subgraph, which I'm going to call a loop. Okay. Right. Okay.
All right. Yeah, Jay. So far we have come across a few analysis where there is an option to increase the code size for optimization purposes. So it's like in reaching definition, we can specialize the code and we saw one case in lazy code motion but we did not consider it while discussing the algorithm. So how do we decide that while optimizing whether do I need to increase the code size at this point or not, or whether do I need to do duplication or not? Do we have some heuristics for that, or should I can just turn it off completely or something?
Okay. So the question is, look, in multiple times in our discussion through the course, we have come across options where it was possible to make the program faster or more structured by duplicating code, right? One example was when we were talking about lazy code motion and we wanted to remove partial redundancy. And if you want to remove partial redundancy, in some cases, it's just not possible to remove partial redundancy without having to actually duplicate code. Similarly, when we talk about converting an irreducible graph, a graph that is not reducible, to a reducible graph, one way to do that is basically to duplicate code. I just create two copies and then it becomes reducible. Now, how do I decide whether it's a good idea to duplicate or not a good idea to duplicate? What criteria is used within the compiler to make such decisions? I'll talk both about the theory and the practice. Okay. So theoretically speaking, such duplication, as I've also mentioned in the modules, can actually lead to exponential growth in the code size. So I mean, growth in the code size by like 5%, 10% is okay, right? I mean, it's you may say that's acceptable, but a growth which is exponential in size potentially is fatal, right? Because the larger the code, the more memory it's going to consume, the more cache space it's going to consume, and going to have more cache misses, and that's all going to be very counterproductive, okay, overall, typically. Now, so that's the theory. In practice, what compilers do is basically they use heuristics to figure out whether it is okay to do code duplication or not. I haven't discussed this particular transformation, but I'll use that as a very important transformation that compilers do all the time, which involves code duplication, and that is called inlining, okay? So what is inlining? Let's say I have a small function, and let's say I have one function foo that is calling another function bar, okay? And bar is being called from different functions, let's say foo1, foo2, foo3, and so on. And within foo1, I basically figure out that if I just copy the code, the body of foo, copy the body of bar inside the body of foo1, then I can do better optimization, because now, I mean, instead of making a function call, I can just basically copy the code here and then specialize that code in the context of foo1. And that can potentially open opportunities for vectorization and things like that. Now, inlining is one of the most important optimizations in terms of the improvements it provides in terms of running time and things like that. And the frequency of its occurrence, the frequency of opportunity. Recall that when we evaluate an optimization, it is basically, typically on two important metrics. One is, how frequently is this optimization going to get triggered? If that optimization is going to get triggered only once in a, once in 10,000 lines of code, then what's the point spending so much effort on that, right? I mean, I have more. Second, when it gets triggered, how much improvement does it produce? And so inlining actually scores very high on both these metrics, because why is it very frequent? Well, if you look at most of your code, especially in object-oriented languages, you are used to writing getters and setters. So you have a class, and then you basically have getter method and setter method that's going to just meant to access a particular member variable. And this gives you a nice separation between reads and writes to member variables. But now, just to get, I have to make a function call, And because of that, if I treat it as a function call, then lots of optimizations get precluded. Because, I mean, after all, it was just a memory access. And now I have hidden it behind a function call. And maybe that memory access I could have vectorized, parallelized, done induction variable analysis on. But all that opportunity just goes out of the window the moment I treat it as a function call. Okay. And so one of the very consequential optimizations, especially for object-oriented languages, like C++, Java, and so on, is inlining. And inlining involves duplication of code. Okay. And also in this particular example that I just used of getters and setters, you can also see that the optimization is also very consequential. I mean, the moment I kind of inline the getter to just a memory access, then suddenly, you know, I open myself to so many other types of transformations, like including DFAs, induction variable analysis, and things like that, available expressions, and so on. Okay, so the compiler has to walk a tightrope between code size and all these opportunities, and inlining is one big example where it needs to really make these odd choices, because you know a bad choice can increase the code size exponentially, a good choice can improve the runtime significantly. So you know the pros and the cons are actually balanced in that case. In the case of, for example, lazy code motion, it's not so clear that the pros and the cons are equally balanced. The cons seem very high because the cost of duplication seems pretty high. The pros, on the other hand, maybe not so much. I mean, it's just an extra kind of computation, and depending on what is the size of that computation. I mean, if it's just a plus, then that maybe not. But if that plus was actually a matrix plus or something like that, or matrix multiply or something, then yes, it makes sense, right? So depending on that. What do compilers do? The typical heuristic for deciding whether to do duplication or not is to basically figure out what's the size of the code that's being duplicated. And this is especially true for inlining. Okay, so for example, compilers would have a threshold that you can only inline the callee if the size of the callee is smaller than a particular threshold, right? Maybe, you know, tens of instructions or something like that, because more than that, I'm kind of, playing a risky game with my instruction cache size as well. Okay, and unfortunately, these thresholds are typically static. And then there are a bunch of other heuristics also that, what do I think about in the caller context? Do I think that there is a potential for more optimization? Now, once again, there's a phase ordering problem here. If I inline, I may have enabled more optimizations, but then I don't know ahead of time whether it will actually do vectorization or whether it will actually do better available expression. I really don't know ahead of time. Now, one option is I try to inline, then I see whether I'm going to get a better option. If not, then I backtrack and then I don't inline, right? I just kind of leave it as it is. Now that's, for a compiler, that's typically not done, because this kind of backtracking is too super expensive, and compilers need to work in a limited time envelope, like maybe a few minutes or something like that. So this backtracking is typically not used at all in compiler. Compiler needs to make heuristic decisions quickly, so that basically we figure out what the answer is. So typically, what it will do is it will use heuristics even to decide whether in the context of the caller, do I expect things to improve if I inline? Okay, so what are some heuristics that can be used there? Well, for example, if I'm inside a loop body and there is no other function call, or all other function calls have been inlined, then it seems like if I inline this particular code, then maybe I would have opportunities for loop invariant code motion or induction variable analysis or whatever, right? And so that's going to be, but in the caller context, it's not even a loop, and so I don't really expect it to be executed that often. Why bother, right? Why increase my code size, because this code is only going to be executed a few number of times? So those are the kind of heuristics. Number one, size of the code being duplicated. In case of inlining, that means size of the callee. Number two, expected improvements, heuristic based, and I could go wrong. Expected improvements, heuristic based, in the context of the caller, if I inline, if I duplicate. Okay, so these are the kind of heuristics that people use. Now, I the question that you asked originally was in the context of reducibility and lazy code motion, but I answered the question in the context of inlining, because inlining is by far the most important optimization where this trade-off is more balanced. For other things, it's typically the compiler doesn't really bother about duplicating. I mean, inlining is by far the biggest case where the compiler bothers about inlining, and there it uses heuristics. And I should tell you that compilers are typically making very strange choices. Okay, it's not like they're doing a great job currently. Okay, so there's huge room for improvement here. You would find lots of kind of studies or stories which say that, oh, I just added one extra line and my Linux kernel became 5% slower. And the reason was that suddenly the heuristic of the compiler stopped triggering and it stopped inlining. Okay. And just because it started crossing the threshold of the inline size, you know, code duplication size, just because I added one line. Right. And so now the developer can have a good time identifying why, you know, that one line caused 5% degradation. I mean, he'll just be at loss unless he tries to dig into the assembly code to figure out what the compiler did. Right now. So these kind of issues are actually pretty complex and unfortunate in today's world. Yeah.